The lecture demonstration is about our recreation of La Création du Monde from 1923. In 2000, in the spring, we received a telephone call from Geneva from a woman named Cynthia Odier, who was about to start a foundation called Fluxum with the idea of creating a laboratory for young artists to create new work and also for all kinds of artists to show and share their work, including chefs and photographers and all kinds of artists. She asked us if we would be the creation of her foundation and would we be able to do a version that we would make up ourselves, create new, which we do sometimes, with this music and these designs. And we said, well, Madame Odier, we will be happy to do that, but as it happens, we have done quite a lot of research about this ballet because we were fascinated by it. And if you want, we will try to do a recreation as close as we can to what happened in 1923. And she was really excited because in Geneva, at the Museum of Art and History, there was an exhibition of Léger's work and also the Barbier-Müller collection of art, so-called primitive art, of the African collection of this particular man, Barbier-Müller. So the ballet was performed first in the context of this exhibition, and it was on a purpose-built stage in the museum garden, except it was winter, so it was all covered with heaters. At the end of our presentation, we're going to show you a few film excerpts from that garden. I just want to warn you in advance that you will see the orchestra in the fountain. There is no water, and the orchestra was very nervous when we said we wanted them in the fountain, because it was a very beautiful stone circle, and the orchestra is at the Ensemble Intercontemporain, and they were inside that. So you will see at the end of our presentation several excerpts from that first stage production. So how did we do this? Part of our talk today is telling you how. At each stage we'll come back to how did we do this. But just as an opening idea, it's not just how, but it's why. In the course of other work, we met Madame Milo, Madeleine Milo, the French say Milo, the wife of the composer of La Création du Monde, and she talked to us a lot about this production. She made us really interested. In the course of reconstructing another ballet by Léger called Skating Rink, we met two dancers who had actually been in those productions. And one of them particularly gave us a lot of information about La Création du Monde. So our method has always been to treat this lost work, whichever Nijinsky's Rite of Spring or the Skating Rink of Léger or La Création du Monde of Léger, Sandrart, etc., to treat it like a puzzle, and we're looking for all the lost pieces. Sometimes people call us dance detectives, and we like that, actually. That's fun, to be a detective. And it is like that, because we look for all the clues, and then we have to make sense. We have to put it together. So a good part of our work is studying the context. We read lots of magazines and articles. We read biographies and autobiographies. We try to immerse ourselves in the world of these people. The world of 1923, out of which came La Création du Monde, is very much the world in recovery from the First World War. Each of the people involved was very affected by the war. Sandrart himself was seriously wounded. Faust had said this morning he'd lost a leg. We thought he'd lost an arm, the poor man. Sandrart was a great poet, and he spent a lot of time in Africa, but he also spent a time in the war. Léger spent the war in the trenches, and he had this craving for color because it was so gray, so wet, so cold, and so desperately depressing to be around all this death. So the Great War, so-called, is said, I think, very aptly by someone, great in the sense of the enormous destruction and depression it created. Half of the generation of 1914 died in the war, the men, half. So these people who made this ballet, now let's remember they had 15-minute ballet. They are trying to talk in 15 minutes about this experience, but it is not a documentary about the horrors of war. if you saw La Création du Monde on the stage last night, you saw something very beautiful, something quite bright, sometimes somber, other times, but it's about hope. It's the hope for a new world. The interesting paradox is that these artists all felt they needed to look outside the European framework. Darius Milhaud had just been traveling in the United States. He was playing jazz with orchestras in Harlem. He was in Rio de Janeiro collecting sambas. He was immersed in the black music world, but he never went to Africa. Sandrart created his Anthologie Nègre, this wonderful collection of stories, which are really stories by European missionaries. This is Africa at one, two, three removes, but they were based on the stories. The myth that Sandrart chose, the creation of the world, is not actually the first creation. And this is the crux in terms of the war. It's about the second creation of the world. Because in this story, which is based on a West African tale, the deities, conceived by Léger as these three huge sculptures, which you will see, the deities were so discouraged by what mankind did the first time, they burnt the lot. They burnt the whole of creation. And then they tried again. The character who they wanted to destroy in that first creation was named Pham. Pham is like Lucifer in the biblical tradition. And arrogance was his problem. In this piece that you saw on stage last night, at one moment the music stops and you hear, demeurez en silence, Pham et vous écoute, be quiet, Pham's listening. So this is the idea of the piece, is that Pham is this spirit of war, of disharmony, and it can always come back. So La Création du Monde, by these four survivors of World War I, is about the attempt to create again love and harmony, and there's an Adam and Eve in the story, it's the beginning of life again, but there's always the danger that it can be destroyed. When I show you the excerpts at the end, I will tell you a little bit more of detail of this. So now what's going to happen is Kenneth is going to read you the scenario as it was written for the production, so that we have some idea of what the creators said themselves about this. The link to the article that we handed out to you will put in much more context than we can in this short time how we did our research, and why, and what the sources are, and how we use the sources. We hope you'll have a chance to look at that. After Kenneth has given you the scenario, then I'll speak again just for a few moments, and then he will talk to you about the costumes and how we worked on those. Then I'll show you some video. So that's the agenda. We're trying to save 15 minutes because we'd like to have a dialogue about the work at the end. That's okay.
The sky and the earth come to terms with each other. The grand masters of creation, Enzami, Meber, and Enkwa, stand tall in a decor of high mountains and tragic atmosphere. The last flashes of light streak the heavy sky. At the center of the stage can be seen a confused heap of intertwined bodies, a compact mass still in gestation. Enzami, Meber, and Nekwa, the three gods of creation, make magic incantations around this formless mass. Then they make way. The light in the sky hardens, while monkeys and insects follow its course on the ground, and rainbirds pass back and forth. There are sudden jolts in the central mass. Enzame, Meber, and Enkwa dispatch their messengers, the Malakas, mounted on stilts. The animals then form a round, which slowly oscillates like a branal around the central mass. At each turn, another animal shoots out from the center. then mingles in the round, which turns again. All the formless beings that remain on the ground now artfully enter the round and follow it, frenetically and dizzily. These are the magic people, male and female. Enzami, Mibea, and Enkwa disappear during the great drumming. The round stops moving. Two arms reach out. Two torsos rise suddenly and reach for each other. It is man and woman, suddenly upright. They lean forward, recognizing each other. They draw themselves up to full height, facing each other. The clouds disappear. The sky is blue. The couple withdraw into a kiss, which carries them like a wave. It is the springtime of humanity.
So on the screen, you see a drawing of the four rainbirds, the four birds. These are the Cubist costumes by Leger, but this is my own drawing. And what Kenneth always asks me to do, because he's responsible especially for the decor and the costumes, and I'm responsible especially for the choreography, but as dance detectives, we work very closely with each other as assistant. He always asks me to take the drawings of the original designer and make them dance as the costumes will be danced, because he needs to understand the stresses on the costumes. So this is one of my drawings to show him what these birds have to do. In the course of working on the costumes for Leger, for the ballet the year before, Skating Rink, in 1922, we started noticing that the costumes were giving us a lot of information about the characters. So what we've prepared for you today is a deconstruction of the costumes, so that we're going to look at each of the characters in the ballet and see what the costume designs tell us. The drawings that you see will be my drawings based on Leger, my drawings of the actual dancers that you've seen on the stage of the Ballet de Lorraine. So we drew in Geneva, we drew in Florence, but these are the drawings that came from this production that you'll see. So if you're seeing the production tonight, you'll know when you see the costume, you can read the costume. If you saw it last night, you can read it in retrospect. So now we're going to go through the 24 characters and see what emerges about Cubism and about the ballet La Création du Monde.
This presentation demonstrates our deconstruction of costumes for clues to character. The process we first developed when we reconstructed Leger's drawings for Skating Rink from 1922. On the screen, you see the two of us looking at the Création costumes we renovated at the Ballet de Lorraine. Sekoumé, a human being. The first man, the soul of mankind. The costume is monochromatic, black and white, and is padded to exaggerate his muscles. It is stitched with white beads and cowrie shells, used in Africa as money. So he is born endowed with what he needs. Mbongwe, a human being, the first woman, the body of mankind. She is the partner of Sekoumé. Her costume is similar to his. Her padding emphasizes her sensual curves, her femininity. Her mask has a crown of upright braids, and she is adorned with hoop earrings and a necklace. Nisissim, messenger of the gods, model of the human soul, male. First seen in the opening shadow play, which suggests a black and white movie. He wears stilts and carries a lance. A lens like a movie camera is on his mask, typical of Leger's collage of traditional and modern images. Gnu, messenger of the gods, model of the human body, female. She also has a sort of camera on her mask. her skirt of air waves, parallels her partner's peplum of clouds, as they belong to the airy higher world, a quality emphasized by the pennant and many flags that hang from her. Egg Wizard, a magic person, the first of eight Malakars. The magic people assist with the creation of mankind. The mythic materials of egg and water animated by the power of music. Notice the geometrically decorated egg that forms his midsection. Egg Witch, a magic person or Malakar, the egg wizard's partner. She has egg shapes, ovoids on her arms, and her shield has bold waves that suggest her essence will be mixed with water. Among various dots that decorate her costume is a vertical row of small eggs on her skirt. Water Wizard, another magic person, a Malakar. His peplum is decorated with bold, watery waves, and his mask is a cubist echo of the trident carried by Neptune, the Roman god of the sea. His left sleeve, made from a fluid fabric, is shaped like a fish with a split tail. Water Witch, another Malakar. She has a patch of similar waves on her skirt and bears on her chest a large shield with wavy curves. Like the Egg Witch, she wears ovoids, a symbol of birth, on her arms. Both are a mythic mix of egg and water. Marimba Wizard, also a Malakar, one of the two music wizards, both of whom wear keyboards. This one is associated with wood. His arms and waist are hung with vertical keys. He wears dapper spats and what seems to be a piano key hat. Xylophone Wizard, another Malakar. The other music wizard, this one is associated with metal. He has a flat hoop skirt of horizontal bars. He and his colleague are the stylish jazzmen, all dressed up to enliven the creative mixture of egg and water. World Tree Witch, another Malakar, a kind of midwife. She wears a skirt that looks like a brick wall, evoking the earth and the building materials of life. She carries a branch from which woman is born, of man, and also a West African fertility symbol of the world tree. Hatchet Witch, the last of the magic people in the valley. Colleague of the World Tree Witch, this midwife associated with metal bears the hatchet that cuts the branch that represents mankind's future. She and the World Tree are the only witches that carry the fertility symbol. Orange Winged Bird. There are four birds, all female. Wildly colorful, these creatures of the air have wings on their bodices and feathers on their masks. Their hips are hung with dangling lozenges that tantalizingly hide their long black legs and elongated feet on point. Blue-winged bird. The birds vie with the music wizards in their fashion sense and sheer joy in creation. Blue wing wears a stylized button waistcoat, or at least a cubit fragment of one, topped by a black and white polka dot cravat. Goldwing bird. Goldwing's attributes reveal the bird's dramatic role of defending the first man and woman and the future fertility of the human race. Her wing is heraldic, a shield protecting a decorative egg that makes up her bodice. Green-winged bird. Green-winged bird also has symbols of eggs and water on the shield that constitutes her wing. All the birds defend fertility by being seductive. In the ballet, they save mankind, but they are basically showgirls. Block man fetishist. There are four fetishists, all male. The fetishists are the remnants of the failed first experiment of creating the world. They are the underworld gang of femme, the Lucifer figure whose arrogance prompted the deities to burn the whole of creation. Lattice man fetishist. Two of the fetishists have attributes of the man-made world. The lattice man's mask shows Leger's fondness for urban construction images in his paintings and costumes. Like Blockman, Lattice Man has a brick-coloured shield. Birdman fetishist. The other two fetishists have attributes of the natural world. Birdman's mask has a creaturely shape and the restricted palette of night and day. All the fetishists wear big, heavy-soled shoes that bind them to the earth. Circle man fetishist. Circle man, another denizen of the natural world, has a military bearing with a scalloped collar and epaulette on his shield. He is ringleader in the attempt to steal the branch of mankind's future from the human couple. Red monkey. There are two monkeys, both male. The monkeys are the world's first comedians and work as a pair like N-men in vaudeville. Their long arms enclose dancing canes that enhance their acrobatic moves. This monkey has a jaunty red leg and bodice. Yellow monkey. This monkey is equally zany in his mix of stripes, spots, and zigzags. For the monkey's face masks, Leger seems to be playing with the mesh that fencers wear. And these characters join in the fight to defend mankind. Striped insect. There are two insects. The first is male. These creatures are destined to crawl the earth, but do have wing flaps, enabling them to leap for short flights. They have masks like crocodiles, but pose no threat as they admire the birds and help the humans. Speckled insect. The second insect is female. The wing flaps and antennae of the insects are colored like street signs, another example of Leger's love for urban surfaces. When the insects get to stand upright at the end, their blue carapaces transform into tuxedos.
So this is actually one of the dancers from the Ballet of Lorraine, and me with my iPhone taking the picture of her during the costume try. So you can see how the actual cagoule, the headpiece, fits onto the body at the top of the leotard. So the company has a very stable production now. We premiered the work with Faustin a year ago. So from 2000 in Geneva to 2003 in Florence, and then to beginning in Brussels, and then Paris and other cities, and now finally here, we've been able to see the company mesh. What Faustin wanted to do was to make our piece like the centerpiece, like a memory of the dancers as they're developing his ideas about the piece. We're going to look now at the backstage story of how it was to do the reconstruction. We thought you would enjoy seeing an excerpt from a television film that was made at the time of the Geneva production.
Ça fait parler tout le monde, mais ça viendra après le deuxième sujet, parce qu'un spectacle, eh bien, ça réunit différents corps de métiers. On accède donc à une deuxième étape, c'est l'étape décor et costume. Et sur ce sujet, vous allez également découvrir Millicent Hudson, la chorégraphe, et Kenneth Archer, le scénographe et l'historien de l'art. on part pour une destination que vous allez découvrir sur ce sujet.
The workshops are in London.
Question de délai, impossible de réaliser décors et costumes à Genève. Départ pour Londres. Si nous arrivons en plein petit déjeuner, travail et concept sont toutefois bien avancés et menés par deux personnalités captivantes, Millicent Hodson, chorégraphe, et Archer, historien de l'art et scénographe. Un tandem réputé spécialiste de la reconstruction des ballets perdus, notamment ceux de Nijinsky, Balanchine et de Berlin. Nous sommes ici à Hammersmith, chez John Campbell, où le décor inspiré de l'art africain John et du cubisme est en cours de renaissance. Discussion, réajustement ponctuent toutes les phases du travail.
So this British video maker chose the Beatles for our collaboration. This is Cynthia Odier, who started the foundation in Geneva. This is a reconstructed church, that's why it's so big.
De Léger, puis agrandi aux dimensions de la scène genevoise, plus basse mais plus longue. Un résultat insatisfaisant qui débouche sur un troisième dessin, allongé cette fois par de nouvelles silhouettes latérales dans l'esprit de Léger.
This is the front curtain at the very beginning, which is like looking at a movie, a black and white movie.
De 1923.
It's massive, as you can see.
Un exemple qui nous montre le processus de reconstruction adapté au contexte actuel de la recréation. Ample travail de réactivation de la mémoire, finalement très concentré.
La préparation pour le spectacle à Genève a commencé en juin dernier. Et depuis juin, c'est là notre activité principale. Mais avant cela, on peut dire qu'il nous a fallu un an de recherche et de compilation de matériel.
Nous avons retrouvé diverses archives, quelques photographies du ballet original, des esquisses et bien sûr les merveilleux dessins que Léger a réalisés pour les costumes et les décors. Mais nous avons aussi retrouvé les écrits des critiques et des collaborateurs, la partition originale. Nous avons recueilli les souvenirs des survivants, dont une danseuse qui a dansé dans ce ballet. C'est une femme très âgée, mais nous l'avons rencontrée et interviewée. Nous avons aussi interviewé Madame Milo, la veuve de Darius Milo.
Bien sûr, il a fallu collecter tous ces éléments, les trouver pour les rassembler. Les dessins de Léger sont superbes graphiquement, en partie parce que très souvent, ils ne représentent ni les mains ni les pieds. Mais pour les danseurs, cela ne convient évidemment pas. Il nous faut les mains et les pieds. Aussi, dès que nous ajoutons le corps entier, nous devons changer les costumes et en faire une interprétation.
Nous sommes dans l'atelier de Phil Reynolds, à Clerkenwell, là où se préparent les costumes des danseurs.
Notice the materials
Alors,
that they're working with, very light.
Ce serait bien ou pas d'utiliser pour ces motifs-là des éléments comme ces perles. On pourrait utiliser celle-ci, par exemple.
Pour moi, le principe essentiel est que le genou reste libre. Lève ta jambe. Je lève la mienne. Par exemple, je sais qu'il y a un moment où ils vont faire ce mouvement-là. Elle va faire ça, elle va... Non, l'autre jambe. Voilà.
So that you have a little bit of a look into the work on, with these wonderful scenographer, the mask maker and the costumier. They were exceptional collaborators. The costumier, for example, had done a lot of creature works like Batman and cats and things like that. And so they were particularly excited to do this. And also because in 1923, when the ballet was first done, and this we learned not just from the documents that survived, but also from the dancers that told us about the production, these things were made of wood and heavy card. And the dancers were so grateful to Kenneth because he chose these very light fabrics with Phil Reynolds, the costumier. And so that actually what you see on the stage is not a problem. It's a little bit difficult for the birds. They have to keep a certain orientation, but they're not heavy. So the change of technology is something that Léger would have loved. He would have been so grateful. We've seen documentation of his own disappointment with the cumbersome technology that he had to work with. So it was kind of satisfying for us to think that we could do this. Now we're going to look at a few excerpts from the ballet. This is the very beginning. This is called the Heap of Chaos. These are the insects, obviously. This is the very beginning of time. Creatures are finding form. Here come the birds, like showgirls, at the back, with their high kicks. Notice the clouds coming up? Some of these techniques are old theater techniques brought back for this. You see the musicians there, and the monkeys. The good thing about the video excerpts is that you can see things bigger and closer. So that's part of the idea, is that we wanted you to get a chance to see the costumes in motion. But if you look at a full video of the performance, even if you see the performance, it's at a distance from you. So the next excerpt we're going to see should come straight away. We're going to see what Kenneth calls the branle. This was in the original notes. The branle is like a French term for a round dance. So this is the round of creation. This is when all the magic people are mixing the eggs and the water with music to create mankind. And the gods are moving around thinking about all this, if they're going to let this second chance for mankind happen. These are the midwives. This object, the world tree that they're holding, this wooden stick, is really important. And for us, it was so fascinating because the composer that worked with Faustin has spent a lot of time in West Africa. He's an Italian composer. And he recognized this as a Dahomeyan, West African fertility symbol, this square on the straight stick. So that's the hatchet woman there that Kenneth was telling you about. And there you see the water witch behind, and an insect. And behind them, another magic person, the messenger. On your left, that was the xylophone. Now, of course, we have to see the birth of mankind. That's the first important event. And now we're going to see all the characters preparing for the moment when man and woman are born. You can see how the keyboards move on the xylophone and the marimba. Now here comes the first midwife. She puts the fertility symbol down, lies on it, you see where she is? Now here, suddenly a man is born, and they open up, and there he is, full grown. In the production in Geneva, this was a wonderful dancer from Alvin Ailey in New York who had joined the Geneva Ballet. So now that they've prepared him, they've done everything they have to do for the woman to be born. And you see that there's a branch between them. So instead of being born like Eve from the rib of Adam, Mbangwe is born from the world tree, from the branch of the tree that represents the future of mankind. So this is their love duet. This is their private moment together. So the big challenge choreographically with this, and even Mio's widow talked to us about this, was to keep the masks frontal as much as we could, because it's all made to be seen from the front. So we have to show them embracing, but keeping their faces forward as much as they can. Now suddenly they're going to be interrupted, because they're involved in their love tryst. They don't notice anything else that's going on. He feels something's happening. He warns her. And this is when we hear this warning. Demeurez en silence, femme, et aux écoutes. Be quiet, because femme's listening. In order to inflict misery on mankind, disharmony wants to come back. The idea of war, of disharmony, disunion, is always with us. And then, of course, there has to be the defense of this human branch. These creatures of femme come, the fetishists, and try to steal it from the man and the woman. And that's the central drama. Once they achieve that, then there's this big celebration. And this is it. This is the finale. Remember, this is a 15-minute work. And the model for it is like a stage review. So it's kind of like a show, a vaudeville show in a sense. And here they dance together, the monkeys with the human people, the insects in the back there. You see the others in partnering. Monkeys come across. So this is the big celebration. It seems like the end. So this is typical of a jazz structure here, where you have, like in ragtime, an ending and then another ending. Here are the bugs making love. This is the question, how do bugs make love? There's your answer. So this seems like this is this great happy ending. We know they used the Charleston. This is like for Jean Berlin, the choreographer originally. He made a kind of collage at the end of the popular dance styles. But now they're forming, you can see they're forming into a round. And the gods are coming back behind. You see how the bug's carapace when they stand up looks kind of like a tuxedo. So that was also a clever thing. Those are the messengers on the side. And they're the ones who do this kind of tap dancing. So there is another ending. And the sources for Mio are fascinating. You can read about this in our article, because he grew up in a Jewish household in France, and he uses Hebraic chants as behind some of this Brazilian and Harlem music to create this sense of solemnity for the creation of the world. And he comes back to that in the coda at the end. The coda is very reflective. So after this great vaudeville finale with everybody kicking, everybody doing the Charleston and whatnot, then there's this very somber ending. It's a nostalgic ending, almost like they're afraid that this world too will be burned. Every time we stage the work, we do this ending a little bit differently. We try to, because nobody knows exactly what this work was like. It wasn't as easy to document, in fact, as some of our Balanchine works or the Nijinsky works. And so we have a certain latitude, and we try to build it around the company and around the situation. And for this situation, we felt it was very important, after this nostalgic round, that we have an unmasking that you will see the dancers do at the very end. What we did in Geneva was we had a costume parade that the dancers actually went out into the audience so that people could see close up the costumes. But with Faustin's work following, of course, we wanted to keep the dramatic closure. So we just have them remove the masks. But the idea is that, like the beginning, the heap of chaos, at the end, everything comes back into this round. All the sources of creation come together. And even the fetishists have been tamed by the birds. And they stole back the branch. So it ends on a happy note, but it's always possible. It's always possible that they can lose it again. And so then you see them tip their heads, and it's really quite reflective at the end. There's the orchestra in the fountain. And so that was the Geneva production.
If you have a question, please stand up and ask the question with a strong voice.
Thank you very much for the presentation. I have a question in terms of the reconstruction concerning the material, because you were saying that Léger had the problems because the material of the costumes were so heavy, and so you have the opportunity now to use more lighter material. But the question for me would be, how does that challenge also the character of the dance and the ballet? Because if they have to wear heavy costumes, I mean, the whole dance, I guess, and spacing and so on is different to what
we did a recreation
in 1923. Léger wanted to move more in the direction of Gordon Craig, and the dancers could have been treated more or less as extras who carried bits of scenery.
Gordon Craig had this theory of theater props, some of many of you must know, the performer as a moving mask. But actually, this is really an essential question, because if we're doing the choreography as close as we can find it to 1923, how can we do that if they couldn't move? But that's exactly what the dancer whom we found, Greta Lundberg, who was in the original production, she said, what Jean Berlin, what Jean asked us to do, we could not do. So in a way, in 1923, they never really did the choreography that was intended, because what he planned was so inhibited by the weight of the costumes. So she told us what he wanted to do, and so we tried to realize that ourselves. But as Kenneth says, even when we have as maybe 80% documentation of a piece, we still call it, you always say famously, a reasonable facsimile. We don't pretend that we can get 100% what happened, because we're not psychic.
But we often have this problem when we did Skating Rink, which Leger designed for in 1922. He was very disappointed with the way that they were realized. And when we did that, first of all, with the opera in Zurich, we used different techniques, and it looked much more like the way that Leger originally had conceived it.
Yeah, there's some letter we found from Leger to his wife where he's saying, oh, they look like Provençal folklore skirts, you know, and they're supposed to be Cubist costumes. So what Kenneth did with the costumiers in Zurich is that they took piano wire and they took hat wire so that they're skating, right, in the skating rink. So they're skating all the time, so there are like lots of collisions and falls. So if you fall in this piano wire skirt, it bounces right back. So also as they come around in this kind of cyclorama, they're skating the whole time they're coming around. The men have the big shoulders like this, and the women have the big skirts like this. So they come toward you this way, I'm a woman in a skirt, you see this Cubist costume. And as soon as I turn here, I'm like, and they were really skinny, there's nothing here. And they turn again and it's like this. So for the men, the shoulders, for the women, the skirts. So we tried, for Leger's sake, to get away from the Provençal dancing skirts and create the sculptures.
We always try to be dancer friendly. For instance, some of you might have seen The Rite of Spring at the Champs-Élysées Theatre with Sasha Walsh's new piece last week. Well, when we did that, originally in 1913, the costumes were made of heavy flannelette and heavy wool. And the dancers really suffered because they were soaking with perspiration the whole time. So when we did the reconstruction of The Rite of Spring, we used very lightweight material, silk noir, which took the paint in the same way, which moved over the body in the same way, but they were much easier to dance in.
So, you know, technology is an advantage, and it's our principle that we should take advantage of that.
Other questions? Yeah, please.
May I come back to your initial question?
Could you please stand up? Maybe it's better than for the room to... Yeah.
May I come back to your initial question, which you posed to us as a sort of statement of why do this recreation? I would like to ask, why do it now, today, and why, you talked to us about this foundation, the fact that the funds were available, you were obviously able to fund the project and the research, but why do it now, and why was the choreographer Faustin, why was he interested in doing it now? Other than recreate a historical piece, there are all kinds of complex things happening in the choreography that I saw last night. And it seems to me structured in three parts, of which yours is the centerpiece. The last part, as we can see, is a very angry piece. I would call it aggressive, probably necessarily aggressive, but it's a very debatable and difficult work as an ensemble. So why would Faustin as choreographer be interested in doing this with you, who are interested in doing this now? It's a kind of social question I'm asking.
You've asked a number of questions in one there. First of all, why do we want to do it and why do we want it now? Well, we want to do it because we love some of these beautiful artworks. I love the designs of people like Leger and Nicholas Roeg, and you can't really see the beauty of their designs unless they are on the stage. So that's why I do it.
For the choreography, one thing that really interested me was that this piece, La Création du Monde, helped create the taste in Paris for black dance. And I spent a long time in my work on Maya Deren, who did a lot of filming of black dance in New York in the 40s and 50s. I had a great training in African and Caribbean dance, and I was really interested what happened in Paris that created such a great wave of fashion for black dance. La Création du Monde was one of the first things that created that taste. And after La Création du Monde, one half year later, was the end of the Ballet Suédois, and Rolf de Marais, the impresario, closed the company and took over as impresario for the black dancers, for Josephine Baker and for the different revues nègres that started happening. We have to understand this in a certain way as a kind of fusion movement that was happening in the 20s. There was this big movement in New York, someone mentioned this morning, about Shuffle Along, Blackbirds, these revues. Suddenly, these revues, which started to lose their Broadway audience, began to have a Parisian audience because of Rolf de Marais and the Champs-Élysées. I was interested in Création du Monde as a bridge that created a cultural bridge that opened a way. And it partly came from Milo, because he had traveled in New York, he traveled in Brazil. He really had a passion for African music of the diaspora. He never went to Africa.
Sorry, I may have formulated my question badly. I suppose what I'm asking is, did you dialogue with Faustin Linier Kuala? Did you dialogue with him because the third part seems to be, in fact, an interrogation of the middle.
No, not until after.
Because what you said about black dance is, in fact, seems to me, last night was really being interrogated by the third part.
Yes, yes, absolutely. And I think, you know, this whole question of the sort of like the colonial attitude of Europe, I think it's very real, and we have to remember that in like the 1920s, Frantz Fanon, the great theorist of the 50s, none of that existed yet. So there wasn't a cultural critique of colonialism at that point. So for Faustin, his explanation, and we can't speak for him, his explanation is that he questioned, what is this ballet nègre? As it happened in the 1930s in the United States, there were lots of ballet nègre. There were many black ballet dance companies. There were many black classical dancers. Arthur Mitchell at the New York City Ballet was not the first. So there is a whole movement that happened. But for Faustin, encountering it as a young Congolese choreographer, he sees, here's this work from the early to mid-1920s calling itself a ballet nègre. How can it do that? You know, this was a kind of, not a cliché, but a handle at the time. There was something called bal nègre. Just there had been bal apache, these like, it's like dance hall, like tea dances, apache dances, the kind of pre-Lindy Hop dances. And then there were bal nègre, so that black dance had become a part of the cultural landscape.
My question is a follow-up to the previous one, which is, how has Faustin's work, you know, impacted your view of the world?
Can you just put the three questions together?
So continuing of your question, my question is, you said you did not include Faustin when you did the choreography, but I saw the film about the creation of the costumes. I saw that all the people with whom you were working were European or white people. Was it purposely that you did not work with Africans to create the new masks and costumes?
Our position was simply that this was created by four European artists. And you can see in the article that we wrote, that La Création du Monde is not an African ballet. It is a ballet by four Europeans remembering the war, looking to Africa as a new model. So it is actually a cubist collage, and the black dance that you see in the film, in the piece and in the film, is not really per se ethnographic. It's the black dance that they saw in Paris in those years. Do you understand? So they saw show dance.
My question, if it was purposely from your side, that of course you said you wanted to be as close as possible to the time of 1923.
We wanted to recreate the 1923. I will say, though, in Geneva, for our first cast, when we had the opportunity for the first man and the first woman, we took this dancer, Askia Smith, who was a black dancer from New York, from Ailey, and we took a black female dancer who was from the Caribbean. It was our choice to use two black dancers for the duet, because we had two black dancers who were the best and were really good at it.
One last question, and then.
Do you have any notes on choreography, or is it just the two dancers you were talking to?
There are lots of reports in the press And we use these. There are the photographs that survive. There are the memoirs of the people who were involved that didn't survive, and so we couldn't talk to them. Then, of course, the woman who did survive. And then the drawings, as we can make sense of the drawings as well. So there, it is a collage. For our part, it was a collage, and in the first place, was a collage.
It doesn't really say anything about the steps, you know. And
oh, insofar as we knew that they used the black bottom, we knew they used the Charleston. We knew that the plastique, there's a lot of conversation in the reviews about plastique. That was kind of like the word that modern dance, I mean, here it was called ostrich dance eventually, but the idea of something that is not balletic, and especially also using the torso a lot. This was the kind of signature of Jean Berlin. He was trying to use a new plastique. So this expression dance, expressionist dance, was the style of the Ballet Suédois, essentially. And that's what Berlin was doing. So yes, we do have fragments. It is only fragments. It's not an attempt to make exactly the work. But of course, we wanted to create the atmosphere as much as we could.